Hello all, welcome back to the channel and my messy little basement. I have no excuse, I apologize. I really need to get on track of cleaning this place up, but as you can see before you, I've been to the city again, I have the car fixed, it's doing fine, and as you can see, I let my emotions take over my wallet again. What we have in front of us are a vintage pair of DCM TimeFrame TF350 speakers, and a vintage Sony receiver. Now, in my defense, I was only looking for these speakers. Allow me to explain. See, back in the 80s, mid-80s or so, there used to be a store in Swift Current, Saskatchewan called Decabella's. I loved that store. It had all the high-end goodies you could ever want, and I spent a tremendous amount of time there. And before I continue with the story much further, if Ken, Hal, or George, the guys who work there, are watching this video, thanks for putting up with me. I seriously appreciate it. Anyhow, I spent every waking moment I could at that store, and anyhow, one of those days I was at that store, my dad came in to pick me up, and he had to drag me out of the store like usual, but before he managed to do that, I tried to convince him to buy some of the stuff they had at the store. And they had it set up so that there was a front room and two back rooms. The front room had some of the good stuff, some of the good car audio stuff, and some fairly high-end home audio gear. And in one of the two back rooms, they had more car audio stuff, kind of the stuff I didn't really care so much about. But then there was this other back room. The other back room had the real high-end stuff. In the front room, they had Sirwin Vega speakers, Wharfedale. They had some of the Carver stuff up front. And, oh, let's see, what else did they have? Some of the more high-end Japanese brands were there, like TIAC and whatnot. But in the back room, that's where the gold was. That's where they had Macintosh and Polk Audio, but they also had DCM back there. And on this particular occasion, I think it was Ken that got us back there to audition a pair of speakers. And yeah, the very first pair of speakers I heard from that back room were DCM TimeFrame TF1000s. And if you know me, you also know that I'm real keen on speakers that don't use traditional designs, like, oh, say, those tapped horns back there. And these are such speakers. See, the DCM TimeFrame series are transmission line speakers. And I've only heard transmission lines a couple of times in my life. There was one time I walked into this thrift store of some sorts, and I heard all this deep bass coming out of these tiny little speakers, and I thought, what the heck is going on here? Those speakers turned out to be Admiral Tunnel Reflex speakers using 4-inch Fostex drivers, full range, and they were putting out serious levels of bass, and I couldn't believe what I was hearing. But yeah, the second time I heard transmission line speakers were the TimeFrame TF1000s at Decabella's, and blew my mind all over again. They sounded honestly better than the Sirwin Vega speakers I'd been ogling moments before. And those Sirwin Vega speakers happened to be the Sirwin Vega... Oh, what was it now? My brain's out. Sirwin Vega 2015s. If you've ever seen a pair of those, they're monstrous. They've got 15-inch woofers, 6 mid-ranges, and at least one tweeter. Maybe more than one. But they are seriously big speakers, and they sounded seriously good until I listened to a pair of TF1000s, which blew them out of the water. So yeah, all these years later, I've been wanting a pair of DCM speakers for my very own, vintage, unmodified. And sadly, these are not those speakers. These are the TimeFrame TF350s, and they have been monkeyed with. But it's because they've been monkeyed with that I got them. See, the seller was originally asking $250 for these speakers. I didn't even know about that receiver till I showed up to buy these speakers. But anyhow, from the pictures alone, I could tell that something seriously was off about these things. So I am extremely curious, or I was extremely curious. She dropped the price down to $100, so I thought, for $100, I will take the deal and go for it. Now, this is despite the fact that Turn Up Records and Hi-Fi in Calgary has a pair of vintage, unmodified TimeFrame TF400s. Those are a bit newer than these. So, yeah, the TF400s were $400. I couldn't quite justify that just yet, so I went for these 350s. So, enough talking, let's take a look at them. What makes me think they've been monkeyed with? Well, not the front. At least not the front at first. Once I got them home, I found red flags everywhere. So, we'll get into that stuff in a minute or so, but as you can see, we've got the DCM logos up here. These are supposed to be facing the inside, just like I've got them set up here. They are a mirror image. There's a woofer somewhere up in here, and then there's a tweeter down here. These are two-way. The TF1000s are three-way, and the TF2000s are monstrous and extremely rare, and I want a pair. But, yeah, the red flag started back here. Come on, gimbal. Yeah, we got a missing terminal cup down here. And you'll see that the grill cloth is sort of off-center. That's because once I got this home, I immediately tore into this one to see what the heck was going on with it. But, like I said, more on that later. As you can see, they've been modified down here as well. There is supposed to be a little swivel-out foot that comes out to stabilize these speakers, and those are gone. Instead, someone's affixed these plywood type dealies here, and they do the job, but I think I might be modifying these, or at least making them try to look better. The other one's like that too, but the other one still has its terminal cup. And I think I want to get rid of these. I hate these spring terminal types. They're terrible. I would rather have banana plugs back here, but that will require some modification if I do that. So I might end up just going with the regular terminal cups. I don't know if we've got enough space in there to really do the job. But yeah, I knew they'd been modified just from this stuff alone. So once I got them home, I got into this one to see what was going on with it, because there's serious red flags out front that I'll show you in a second. But first, in order to get into these, you've got to take these weird bases off first, or the swiveling foot off first. Then you take the base off, and then you unroll this grill sock from the bottom to the top. That's how I got into that one. But come on, gimbal. But first thing I did when I got them home, I knew they'd been opened up. I knew they'd been screwed with. So I took a bright flashlight, like so, and I got in here to look at the woofer. And I don't know if you can see it too well. That is not a stock DCM woofer in there. That is a, well, I didn't know what that was at first. I know what it is now. And we'll talk about that in a second. And down here, where I was supposed to find a Vifa D19T tweeter, that's not the stock tweeter either. Let me show you what a D19 tweeter actually looks like. If my gimbal will cooperate. These are a vintage, authentic, irritating gimbal. These are our vintage, authentic pair of Camber 0.5s. These are extremely high-end, and I call these my studio monitors for a reason. These are Vifa D19T tweeters. This is what they're supposed to look like. Three screws, nothing around the center. And when we go back to the DCMs, what we see is a tweeter with four screws around the center and four screws around the edge. So those are not stock. At least I don't believe they are. DCM kind of switch things up once in a while, so could be wrong. Those could be actual originals. I'm not sure. I did take them out. I didn't find any screw holes where I didn't expect to find any, so it could be that they switched up the VIFA tweeters for these drivers eventually. But yeah, what these are really known for here in 2023 is foam rot around the woofers. And I suspect that's what happened with these. The foam rotted out. They couldn't find a way to fix it properly, which is actually not that hard, quite frankly, and easier to do now than it was probably when this was done. But these are not the original woofers, and I've confirmed they're not the original woofers. I've had this apart, and what we actually have here, I was actually pleasantly surprised for a change. Whoever did the modifications to these speakers knew what they were doing. I can't believe I'm saying that. These are Dynaudio woofers, and I'll show you the footage of me getting inside them here, and you can see what the part number is. These woofers are actually intended, or actually, well, maybe not intended. They're actually, oh, what's the word I'm looking for here? I can't think straight today. They're actually appropriate for transmission line speakers. See, you can't actually just drop a new woofer in a transmission line and expect it to work. It has to be a very specific type of driver. And it has to be specifically tuned for the enclosure, otherwise you're screwing things up. And this, as it so happens, has parameters that are just about identical to what I would want in this design. And as for the tweeter, it's a CS driver. I've never had CS before. I don't know how they sound, but here's what I can tell you about this. The tweeters are 1 decibel more sensitive than the woofers. That's not a coincidence. I can't stress to you hard enough how that is not a coincidence. See, when I'm choosing replacement drivers for a speaker like this, I want the tweeter and the woofer to be real close to each other for sensitivity. And these are within 1 decibel. That's not an accident. I'm sorry, it's just not. And it does appear that the crossover might have been recapped as well. I'm not sure. But honestly, I'm real excited to listen to this now because these are not cheap drivers. Not by any stretch of the imagination. The stock DCM drivers were kind of on the cheap side, especially the woofers, but DCM always worked their magic with it, and what can I say, Steve Eberbach, he's the man. At least as far as transmission line, commercially available speakers go. Not like that Amar Bose fellow that kind of cribbed off of his work, but we won't talk about that. Anyhow, those are the speakers. I'm excited to listen to them. We're going to do that in a second, but first we're going to look at this receiver. And before I do that, let me just shut you off for a second so I can get these speakers off this table and over by the projector screen over there so we can actually have a proper listen to them. All right, allow me to introduce you to my brand new to me Sony GX67ES receiver. This is not a stereo receiver, this is a audio-video receiver, an early ProLogic unit, but it'll do the job, I'm sure. The intention behind this is to replace my piece of junk Sanyo up there. Yeah, this thing needs a new power switch now. I'll show you what's going on with it. Oh yeah, the one time I want it to act up, it doesn't. But you can see the lights flickering a bit there. Maybe you heard a little bit of electrical arcing. Yeah, the power switch in that thing is bad. And it's not a good enough receiver for me to keep around, so I'm probably going to recycle that. And the idea behind this is to replace the Sanyo. So, I didn't actually tell the lady that I was looking for a receiver or an amplifier like this. She just happened to have it there. She just hadn't listed it yet, and she wanted $150 for this. And I thought, given that it's an ES receiver, it's probably worth it. Now, these are known for going into protection, kind of like the other Sony albatross around my neck that I was never able to fix. And I should probably take another look at that receiver at some point. And I probably will at some point, but just not this point. See, unlike that receiver, this one has never been monkeyed around with. It's never gone to some technician that left half the screws out and all the boards floating around loose inside. So at least this one's got a chance of working. That's all I care about. So, we're gonna try this out too. I'm gonna drive the DCMs with it, and hopefully it works. And normally I'd be reluctant to fire the output of this into a couple of DCMs because the DCMs were originally like maybe 50, 60 watts. However, the new drivers that are in the DCMs, they can handle a lot more power than the stock ones could, so I'm not so worried about it anymore. In fact, I think this is the receiver they were using to listen to the DCMs back at their house. So, what do we got here? We've got speakers A and B are off. That's exactly what I want. If I can find a way to do it, I will tuck the DCMs behind my projection screen so I can roll them up, or roll the projector screen up and just have a listen whenever I want to, but that probably won't work. But the idea is I can use the A output for the DCMs, I can use the B output for testing new electronics on this table, and Bob's your uncle. So yeah, we've got inputs for DAT, CD, tuner, phono, tape, video tour, laser disc, video one, tape monitor. We've got your usual surround on, off, and mode buttons, Pro Logic mode, level controls for surround level. Got a mute button, loudness control. I'm going to turn that off. I don't know why that was on. Balance control here. Nice big volume knob. Source direct. We're probably going to use that today. Bass and treble, we'll center that because I want to see how those speakers sound as they are. Input balance, interesting. Never had a receiver with that before. And then you've got your usual tuner related stuff here. So, I'm not stupid enough to just fire this up and just try to drive the DCMs with them, or with it. What I am going to do is I'm going to check the operation with the multimeter. First, we gotta plug it in, of course. Okay, and it's already turned itself on, it looks like. Don't know what's going on there. Interesting. I actually did fire this up when I got it, just to see if it would turn on, and it does. But this is kind of weird. Okay, there we go. I don't know why the video mode was on. Then again, I haven't read the instructions first. And I've got the instruction manual, as well as the actual remote for this, which is unusual. Let's see if the volume knob turns itself. Yes, it does. I love a motorized volume knob. Okay, so the operative goal here, I'm gonna switch that to CD because we're gonna use the CD input. And we're gonna come around back while this is turned on. And let's see. Yes, I'm on the A channel, or the A set of speakers. And we're gonna look for DC voltage on the meter at the outputs of the front speakers, if we can get a good connection. Millivolts, that's good. and millivolts. I think we've got working amplifiers in here. And I'm just checking the other speakers now, the surround outputs. This will more than likely have a 4-channel amplifier in it, because that was ProLogic. For ProLogic, you needed a front stereo output, you needed a center channel output, and you needed a surround output. And the surround output is mono. So usually what manufacturers did was... I smell something. I thought I smelled something. Interesting. So anyway, what usually would... I can't talk again. Usually what they did was they used one mono amplifier for both surround speakers. We didn't get all this multi-channel Atmos nonsense until much later. So yes, I think this is working, at least well enough for us to try. And I know the old Kenwood CD player up there is working. We're going to be using that. Wish I had the remote, but I don't. So I'm going to turn that off. And we're going to be listening to this guy. Now, I've been agonizing over what to use for this video because there are a number of tracks I used to tune pro audio systems with that I know extremely well, and all of them are copyrighted or likely to throw copyright issues. And this is probably going to be one of them. However, I've decided that I don't mind if I never make money off of this video, so... we'll just go ahead and see what happens, I think. So we're going to be listening to No Sign of Rain, the title track. And when I say I know this track well, I mean extremely well. I've heard it on everything from $100 boomboxes up to $1,000 MagnaPan speakers. So we're going to find out exactly how good those DCMs are. So let me shut the camera off. Let me get set up. I'm going to use the Zoom H1N to capture the audio from the speakers so you can hear exactly what I'm hearing. And let me get this set up and we'll get going.
Thank you.
Okay, thoughts on the DCM TimeFrame TF350s as they are currently modified and as they currently sit. What do I think about them? And yes, I know there's a broken mirror over there. Don't worry about it. It's blocking your vision of something real special. That's my 1,000 subscriber special tape deck back there. You guys don't get to see that till I get to 1,000 subscribers. Sorry, but I gotta have something special for that momentous occasion, and I'm not ready to show that one to you yet, but I might be. I've heard YouTube is changing things up so that you can get monetized a little earlier than you used to, so maybe I'll drop it early. I don't know, we'll see when we get there. But enough rambling. Thoughts about the DCMs. Well, bearing in mind that I have not heard a stock set of TimeFrame TF350s, keep that in mind. It's important. I've only heard the TF1000s, and those were friggin' phenomenal. How do these compare? Well, immediately after we listened to Kevin Jordan, I popped in something else. I popped in Tears for Fears' Famous Last Words, which is the track I used to tune systems with. It's the first track I go to. And I know that track back in front, like the back of my hand. And I'm going to tell you up front, these do have some frequency response irregularities. It's a little bit chesty. It's like maybe 400 or 500 hertz. There's a little bit of a peak there, but we can EQ that out. That's no problem. As for the rest of it, I am actually quite blown away. These things sound friggin' phenomenal. I don't know how they compare to the rest of the DCM lineup, obviously, but I can compare them to the Magnapans I listened to back in 1990, and they actually get a lot closer than I would have expected. Those Magnapans were just otherworldly, and I wouldn't expect these to hang with them, but they kinda do, honestly. Once I EQ them, it'll be fine. As far as the low end goes, I haven't tried anything extremely low end with these yet, or with any extreme low bass yet. I'm going to do that probably after I shut you off. But yeah, these things really have it going on. This is exactly what I wanted from these speakers. And so what's the plan with these? Well, eventually I want them in my office. I want a nice pair of speakers in there I can just listen to and enjoy music with, so I can do my writing and other such things, and maybe video editing too, we'll see. I don't have room in my office for these yet. I have to work on that. And honestly, considering how the Sony ES receiver sounds, I think they're probably always going to be together. But who knows? I kind of like the idea of leaving the ES receiver out here by my work table there, so I can use it to work on electronics gear with. See, what's in my office right now is my old Pioneer AV receiver. Let me show you. If the gimbal can keep up with me. See, the ES receiver is nice, but this has advanced macaque. That's what I always call it, MCACC. And what that does is it EQs the response for whatever speakers and whatever room you're using them in. And I think this will tame those speakers nicely. Not that they need much taming, because they're friggin' good. So, yeah, that's it for this video. I'm extremely satisfied with the speakers, and this receiver is fully working. I'm a happy guy. We'll get into this later if it ever stops working or starts with the protect mode stuff, but for now, it's phenomenal. I love it. I understand that there's a couple models, or maybe one model above this. That's fine. This is all the receiver I need. This is exactly what I needed. And I didn't even tell her I needed a receiver or an amplifier. She just happened to have it there. So, clearly this woman had some taste, because the receiver is high-end, the speakers are obviously high-end, and honestly, I think what happened is I think the foam brought it out of these woofers, and they got sent back to DCM or something, and they actually replaced the woofers with something that's absolutely perfect for the enclosures. Well, not absolutely perfect. The original drivers are absolutely perfect. But these are close enough that they get the job done, and they do it well, and the tweeters are perfectly matched to it. And I just mean perfectly matched. So I am extremely happy with this purchase. For $100, I got amazing sound. And for $150, I got an amazing receiver. So I am very pleased. Anyhow, that's going to be it for today, guys. Take care.